will really study the pyrolysis of a specific material, and the material that we chose here is an algae. Okay, so we wanted to choose a material like algae and then understand its pyrolysis behavior in these three different systems. Okay, and this is just a motivational slide to say why algae for chemicals and biofuels. It has a very good CO2 sequestration potential, and you know, it is very good because it will it can actually absorb significant amount of CO2 compared to terrestrial biomasses, and the land requirement for its growth is also very low, and it can be grown in wastewater. Okay, and typical algae biorefinery can actually produce biofuels, chemicals, you know, gases, you know, fertilizers, protein supplements, and so on. Okay, so algae contain proteins, carbohydrates, and lipids, unlike any terrestrial biomass. So algae pyrolysis, you know, results in oil, bio oil. Okay, and that results, and you know, the property of this bio oil is from algae is significantly different, and in fact, it is better in many sense compared to conventional terrestrial biomasses like palm, fruit bunch, sawdust, miscanthus, grass, or wood, or anything. You can see that carbon is high. You can see that viscosity is low, equivalent to a light fuel oil. Heating value is very, very high. Okay. Only disadvantage is its nitrogen content is high because algae contain proteins, and proteins are rich in amino acids, which is rich in nitrogen. Okay, so that is the major disadvantage when it comes to algae-based bio oil. But there are ways to really mitigate this so that you can actually, you know, even get rid of this fuel nitrogen, so that you know, the emissions when you are going to use this as a fuel is going to be lesser, are going to be lesser. Okay, so this has actually captured the attention of a lot of researchers, and we have also been working a lot on algae to fuels, both microalgae as well as macroalgae, to produce fuels and chemicals from biomass, from algae pyrolysis. So it's a really a hot topic. Okay, so quickly, I should be able to complete my presentation in 5 minutes, I think. So this is a typical characterization of two different algae that we took for this study. You know, the idea is use all the three different pyrolyzers and then see what is a typical product change in product distribution when we use these algae for the experiments. Okay, so we use two algae. One is Chlorella vulgaris and the other one is Arthrospira platensis. It's also called as spirulina, which is a very good protein supplement. It has very high amount of proteins in it. Okay, and this is a typical, we do a typical proximate analysis, elemental analysis. We also get the data on biochemical analysis and calorific value. So you can see from the thermograms, TGA thermograms, that the typical decomposition regimes of this algae are very, very similar. Although the product distribution from them is going to be very different because of the different biochemical compositions of these two different algae. Okay, so you can see that the basic amino acid profiles of Chlorella vulgaris and Arthrospira platensis are significantly, you know, they are to some extent different. Okay, so Chlorella has more chlorophyll than Arthrospira platensis. Okay, so with this basic characterization, we actually went ahead and pyrolyzed these two different algae samples. It's a simple pyrolysis experiment at one specific temperature without the use of any catalysts or anything. And our idea is repeat the experiments and then also perform a detailed characterization of the products. Okay, so this is the data for Arthrospira platensis, spirulina algae. So you can see that the temperature that is adopted here is for all the three different pyrolysis setups are the same. So you can see that the results, okay, are significantly different from these different setups. Okay, so you can see that firstly, you can see that the carboxylic acids are significant from the micropyrolyzer, whereas in the pyroprobe and Curie point, we see significantly low carboxylic acids. So generally, carboxylic acid is produced, you know, the carboxylic acids are actually present in the form of lipids in the algae. And when you pyrolyze the algae, they are simply released in the gas phase. Okay, so this is an indicator of the primary pyrolysis product from the algae. Okay, so this clearly shows that, you know, in a frontier micropyrolyzer, at least it partially shows that in a frontier micropyrolyzer, the secondary reactions are significantly inhibited. Okay, coming to the hydrocarbons, you can see that hydrocarbons are again cracked products. So when a carboxylic acid undergoes decarboxylation, that means the release of CO2, it becomes a hydrocarbon. So you can see here that, you know, the Curie point pyrolyzer gives a significant amount of hydrocarbons. That means, you know, the carboxylic acids are getting cracked to form hydrocarbons. Okay. You can also see a lot of nitrogen containing compounds being retained, like, you know, amides, amines, nitriles, right? All these are being retained in the products from micropyrolyzer. Okay. And what you see from a pyroprobe is the significant production of phenolics. Okay, and cyclic nitrogen compounds. Okay, so these are typically the secondary decomposition products. Okay, of any biomass or any component. Okay, so this is also evident from the char yields. Okay, so you can see that in a pyroprobe we get significantly high char yields. Again, char yield is an indicator of the you know, of the secondary decomposition. As I said in my initial slide, right? Secondary decomposition can lead to the formation of more amount of solid residue, and that is evident from the pyroprobe result. Okay, and if you go into the details of the hydrocarbon distribution, so you can see that in a so this is a typical distribution. So you can see aromatics are more from pyroprobe. Again, this corroborates the fact that, you know, phenolics are also aromatics, but you can see that aromatics generally are going to be higher from the polycyclics the aromatic hydrocarbons. Okay, and these are aromatic, you know, oxygenates, right? So those are significantly high from a pyroprobe, right? And you can also see here, this is another evidence that, you know, the heating value of the products are actually low from a micropyrolyzer. That means, right, the primary products are not really suffering the secondary decomposition reactions, and hence, right, most of the primary pyrolysis vapors are captured in the GCMS from the micropyrolyzer. Okay. You will see the same result, you know, reproduced here for Chlorella vulgaris, of course, with a different composition. So you can see carboxylic acids are very high, you know, from Chlorella vulgaris. You can see hydrocarbons are significantly high from a Curie point pyrolyzer, more than micropyrolyzer. You can see that phenolics and cyclic nitrogen-containing components are high from the pyroprobe. Okay. And here also you can see that aromatic components, right? Aromatic hydrocarbons, polycyclics, and the aromatic, you know, non-phenols are actually very high from the pyroprobe, right? And you can see the same trend, you know, typically, you know, from the products. Okay. And the char yields, you can see that it is significantly high in the pyroprobe. So what it essentially concludes is, right, our objective has been to compare the product distribution from the different pyrolysis reactors, and in turn, understand what are the typical reactions that these algae components undergo during pyrolysis. Okay, so let me quickly go to these transformations. So you can see that typically an amino acid undergoes a lot of different reactions like decarboxylation, deamination, you know, cyclization, aromatization to form, you know, phenols, benzene, right? Cyclic nitrogen-containing compounds. Okay. Amines and amides. So amides can undergo dehydration to form nitriles. Okay, so these are typical reactions of proteins present in the algae. If you consider lipids are typically triglycerides or long chain fatty acids, right? So typically thermal deconstruction results in the formation of carboxylic acids, and carboxylic acids can undergo decarboxylation, release of CO2 to form hydrocarbons, or the carboxylic acids can undergo amination. Okay, because ammonia is going to be a major product from protein pyrolysis, right? And this amine can actually react with carboxylic acid to form amides, and amides can undergo dehydration to form nitrites. Okay, so these are the typical reactions occurring over here. And coming to the transformation of carbohydrates, right? You can think of typically starch or a cellulose, okay, repeating units of glucose. Okay, so these can undergo, you know, glycosidic bond cleavage and dehydration to form. This is actually one of the major products. It's called as levoglucosan, dehydrated anhydrous sugar, right? And carbohydrates can form indole, pyrrole, pyridine, type of compounds when they react with the amine-based compounds from the proteins. And these can also undergo dehydration to form ketones, aldehydes, and a lot of these different products. Okay. I'll take up the questions once I finish the presentation. So, you know, if you look at the typical time evolution of functional groups, right, this is also a very important information, as I said, from the pyroprobe. This is only from the pyroprobe. So you can see that generally protein-rich algae actually decompose quickly. So you can see that the evolution of the pyrolysis functional groups occur in a very short period of, you know, 5 seconds in the pyroprobe. Whereas you can see that these evolve at much longer time periods of around 10 seconds, in other type of algae, like Chlorella vulgaris. So Chlorella vulgaris, you can say, is a lipid-rich algae, whereas Spirulina, the Arthrospira platensis, is a protein-rich algae. So again, you know, based on the biochemical composition of the algae also, right, the time evolution of the products are going to be significantly different. And this can be understood from analytical pyrolysis reactors. Okay, so coming to Karthik's point about what causes secondary reactions in a pyroprobe? I'm almost done with my presentation, so I can take up the questions then and there. So this is a typical construction of the pyroprobe, right? So in my opinion, you know, there is a lot of heated transfer lines and heated paths that the pyrolysis vapors have to undergo in a pyroprobe reactor. Okay, I don't know if this is the exact reason, but I mean, this is what I think can be a reason. And another thing is, there is always the heating rate is not as fast as in a Frontier micropyrolyzer or a Curie point pyrolyzer. As a result of the vapors have to really go through a lot of stainless steel heated transfer lines in the pyroprobe, which I think is a reason for the typical secondary reactions that are occurring in it. Okay, and again, even here you see here a lot of these C5 to C10 hydrocarbons are aromatic type hydrocarbons that you see significantly from the pyroprobe. This is a typical more detailed understanding based on the carbon number distribution of the products. So you can see that the squalene, neophytidine, phytol, right, these are long chain hydrocarbons that are present in the lipid fraction of the algae, and these are very much retained in a Curie point as well as the Frontier micropyrolyzer. Okay, so these are essentially greater than C17 products. Okay, whereas in the pyroprobe, again, due to the secondary reactions, you get a lot of these aromatic hydrocarbons in it. Okay. So probably my penultimate slide. So I've been comparing the different analytical pyrolysis reactors. And again, in this just one slide, I'll show you what happens if you're really going to go for a large mass of sample. Okay, so we also have developed these microwave pyrolysis reactors in our lab where, and in one study we compared microwave pyrolysis and analytical pyrolysis of three different macroalgae. Okay, and what we found is, again, in the Curie point pyrolysis, I think this is valid both for the Frontier micropyrolyzer also, right? You will see that significant amount of these anhydrous sugars are formed, right? As I said in my previous slide, anhydrous sugars are components like levoglucosan, which are the primary pyrolysis products from the carbohydrates. And these are very much retained in an analytical pyrolyzer, whereas these are nearly absent in microwave pyrolysis because, right, when we take, something like 10 to 20 grams of sample in the microwave pyrolysis reactor, right, it suffers a lot of secondary reactions as the vapors spend a lot of time. So you can see that anhydrous sugars have decreased and furan derivatives have significantly increased because anhydrous sugars can decompose to form, furfural, HMF, and methylfuran type of products. So this is also, it's more like a very general observation, found across different type of samples. To one of the questions from Adriana, Have you researched other biomass in both Frontier and Pyropro? We are doing it. We have not. So this is our first study with algae, and we will be doing more type of biomasses. And these are essentially, the CV type of samples, Khurshid. So the Turbinaria, Sargassum, these are essentially seaweeds collected from the Mandapam camp near Tamil Nadu. Okay, so that's my summary. So what I have described in the past 50 minutes or so is, analytical pyrolysis GCMS is a very powerful tool to characterize a wide variety of materials. And also, nowadays, it's more widely used based on the papers that are being published in journals. It's more widely used for biomass pyrolysis research. And small sample mass, there is some fundamental that really goes into that, right? Small sample mass ensures that reaction occurs in a kinetically controlled design. And mode of feeding plays a decisive role. That is what we observed in our study with algae pyrolysis. So we found that, the Frontier or the Curie Point pyrolyzer results in much faster heating rates, and the secondary transformations are quite low in it compared to the Pyropro. And these are some of our results, right? Carboxylic acids were significant. That's an indicator of the primary pyrolysis products, right? And secondary reactions do occur in Pyroprobe. And we have independently done a lot of studies on biomass pyrolysis in Pyroprobe, and we did find the secondary products, typically aromatic hydrocarbons, are significantly high from it.